Thank you, Doris. Hello. Well, thank you to the organizers of this wonderful symposium. I also really enjoy being in interdisciplinary workshops because I learn a lot. As Doris said, I've been working in graphene for a long time. I arrived to graphene very early on graphene, before graphene was cool. I started working on graphene. And just starting from graphite, I didn't want to use sticky tape. So I developed a method to produce graphene in organic solvents. This method is now called liquid phase exfoliation. Just put pieces of graphite in organic solvents and then sonicate it for a while, and then you get graphene dispersions. And these graphene dispersions were the first time, it was the first time you could quantify a yield. Before, it varied between student to student who will be better with the sticky tape, but with the liquid phase exfoliation, you could actually quantify a yield of graphene production. The solvents we were using initially are not very nice, are hard to evaporate, are hard to work with. So we extended the process to water dispersion, so to aqueous dispersion, just using surfactant molecules. Graphene is hydrophobic, so we could just use surfactants to disperse graphene on in water. And then this actually allowed many scientists around the world to develop applications with graphene. And I really like the quantum properties of graphene, and unfortunately the applications that you can find these days do not actually use the quantum properties of graphene. So I kept working to see if I can show the quantum properties of graphene, how can they be used in applications. So when I arrived to Universidad de Los Andes 7 years ago, first, we needed to produce our own graphene, so we set up the process that we developed at the Max Planck for Polymer Science in Mainz. It's an electrochemical process. It's very easy, it's very cheap, and the graphene that you get is very nice. So it's just the process, the electrochemical process, just creates spaces between the graphite layers, and then you can exfoliate the expanded graphite to produce graphene, and then, so this is the graphene that you can produce, and it is like this. So this is a TM image of graphene. So this is, this here is amorphous carbon, but this is the graphene layer, and from the electron diffraction pattern, you can see that this graphene is very crystalline, it's very nice, it's not graphene oxide. And so this is the graphene that we physicists like, because it keeps the conduction properties electrically and thermal conduction. So you can produce this graphene in aqueous dispersions. Those dispersions you can deposit on any substrate, so the substrate that you like, just by spray coating. You just paint the graphene with an air gun and like this, and you can produce, you know, transparent coatings that are conducting. And recently, one of my students, I avoided graphene oxide for a long time because basically mainly because I didn't understand the chemistry, and also because the chemistry that was used was very strong. You had to leave it for 3 days in strong acid conditions, and I just didn't want to go there. But one of my students said, well, we can just do it using stronger acids in our electrochemical system. So he did, and then expanded the graphite. This is expanded graphite, and then he dipped that expanded graphite in a solution that was less acidic than the initial one. And then at the end, so this, he had some problems here separating this, and at the end, what solved his day was a coffee filter. So he used a coffee filter, and he produced graphene oxide in a process that takes about 3 hours normally preparing graphene oxide takes 3 days, 3 to 4 days. So you can produce graphene oxide just by using stronger acids and in a faster manner. So this is the AFM image of our graphene oxide, and this is the FTIR spectra that shows us that we actually do have graphene oxide. So and these graphene oxide, our initial experiments showed that it's very good when you mix it with a whole transporting material, for example, in a solar cell or an organic LED, because it actually improves the whole transporting layer. So, when graphene was cool, back in, 2008, 2009, when graphene started to be cool, then people said, oh, it's going to solve, all the problems in the world. And we have learned in the past 10 years that it's not that it's easy. But we have been working in developing applications for graphene, so transparent coatings, energy, other 2D materials, reinforcing aerogels you can produce with graphene. But as I said before, we wanted to explore the quantum properties of graphene. So one of the first quantum properties of graphene, it doesn't look very quantum here, but graphene is a material that has a negative expansion coefficient. So what it means is that when it heats up, it doesn't expand, it contracts. So you can produce actuator materials that when they heat, they contract, and then when they cool down, they expand again. So we have a master's student finishing, Julian Rico is finishing his master thesis, studying actuators based on graphene and a polyurethane in a mixture. So polyurethane is transparent to infrared radiation, and because it's transparent to infrared radiation, we just shine an infrared light. It's not a laser. just shoot infrared light to graphene, and it contracts, and then it relaxes again. And by doing some Raman spectroscopy, we were able to extract the negative expansion coefficient for graphene. This has been done in a system where graphene was freestanding. The scientist that did that experiment took about a year and a half to do this sample, to prepare this sample. And with this, we can just measure expansion coefficients just by putting the material in a polymer that is transparent to IR radiation. So this is something that is very exciting because it doesn't take too long to prepare these samples. Then we use graphene also in solar cells. So the lab at Uniandes would like to develop things that will help to produce energy in a more efficient manner. So perovskite solar cells have been fashionable for the last 8 years because their efficiency has gone up from 6% to 23% very quickly. But perovskite solar cells have two problems. One of them is that the most efficient ones are lead-based, and lead is not a great material. It is great material, but it's not great for humans. And also the efficiency or the stability of these solar cells is not great. So they last about 8 hours, so you could have 23% efficiency, but the solar cell is dead in 8 hours. So since we had a group at Uniandes working on perovskite solar cells, we decided to put our graphene on the perovskite solar cells to see to see how it behaved. And so this is an inverted solar cell. This is the electron transporting layer. This is the hole transporting layer. This is the active layer based on lead and organic molecules. And the efficiency, that the highest efficiency we could measure was 14.1%. It's good for this type of configuration, but with a fill factor of 60%. But what was most interesting is that graphene made the stability of our solar cells better. So the stability of solar cells increased by a lot. So they were stable after 5 days. So these type of curves where we were able to measure after 5 days. So so this is something that Liliana Ramos did, and she finished her master's last year, and she's currently writing the paper. And recently we also did some work on preparing solar cells, but having an active layer based on biomolecules. So Marta, she just finished her master's as well. She just extracted this LHC4 protein from an antenna. This is something that she is a biologist, so this is something that she took a long time to do, and she prepared a photoelectrochemical cell, and she showed that when you attach a tag to the protein, then you can align it on graphene. Actually, on graphene oxide, we activated this graphene with plasma, oxygen plasma, so she could align the molecule to, so she could have the active part pointing up and receiving the light rather than in the other direction. And she just submitted this paper, and hopefully the reviewers will be nice to us. So something that we had done a few years ago was just when we were starting to show that our graphene was nice, was using graphene for fluorescence quenching. So it's a bit like playing, like Oliver was telling us about playing billiard on graphene. So we attached gold nanoparticles on graphene, so we put them on graphene. So normally gold on graphene is a very inert surface. So you cannot attach things to it. You know, you have to actually put hydrogen atoms and create a CH bond. It is very hard to put things on graphene. So if you put things on graphene, they slide, and then, you know, play billiard with graphene. But we used surfactant molecules to fix the time, to fix the molecules on graphene, and to study how good was our graphene as a for quenching fluorescence. So you can produce biosensors based on fluorescence, and for that you need a surface that is both a good thermal conductor and a good electrical conductor. And graphene is one of the best thermal conductors in the world. You can check Wikipedia. And we proved that our graphene produced via electrochemical exfoliation had a good quantum efficiency, a very good quantum efficiency. For liquid phase exfoliated graphene, the value for quantum efficiency that had been reported was 7%. We got 40%, very close to the value that had been reported for sticky tape graphene. But you know, if you're going to scale up things, you know, you won't be using sticky tape. So this is something that we did. And recently, we have been working with thermoelectrics, and thermoelectrics is a process that it harvests wasted heat and converts it back into electricity, and we have all suffered with our laptops or our mobile phones that heat up, and then when they heat up, then the usage of battery is not as efficient. So we can harvest some of that heat and convert it back to electricity, and then for that, for example, we could be charging our own body heat. You know, the body is normally 10 degrees higher, higher temperature than ambient heat, ambient temperature, so you could use that. And you measure the efficiency with this figure of merit, this is the Seebeck coefficient, the electrical conductivity and the thermal conductivity. But the thermal conductivity has an electronic part and a vibrational part of the lattice. So when you have nanomaterials, the nanomaterials increase the Seebeck coefficient when compared to the bulk materials. But also, the nanomaterials decouple the thermal and the electrical conductivity from each other, and then you can produce thermoelectrics that are that have good efficiency in one direction rather than in the other. So we wanted to study that, because in this area of, you know, this is where our laptops or our mobile phones work, the efficiency there was not very high, so only a few materials were there, bismuth, telluride. But for high temperatures, this is temperature here, so it's full of lead-based material. So we wanted to see if we could improve things here. And using graphene was the first material that was thought not possible to exist, and because it was thermally unstable, but also was a material thought to be a really bad thermoelectric. So, but is it really bad thermoelectric in this direction? But because it's good electrical conductor, good thermal conductor. But if you build devices in this direction, the thermal conductivity is not as good, and then you can start talking. Yeah. So we build devices of with graphene, and we put polymers or gold nanoparticles in between to induce some phononic blocking, and we measure the figure of merit through a process called the transient Harman method. And the transient Harman method just applies a current and then turns it off and see how the current drops. And then we measure really high figures of merit. And if you remember, for bismuth telluride, the highest value reported was 1.4, 1.5. And we measure values of 2.4 for our devices. This is the with polymers. And this is something that we reported last year. It's something that, you know, we reported, it's there, this value, but we're still working on it because we want to make sure that it was reproducible. So in case reviewer number two is here, it was reproducible, but we wanted to take out the contributions from the substrate, and this is something that we are doing at the moment. So the polymers were not the ones contributing to the high figure of merit. It was graphene. Graphene was actually what was contributing for us to have a high figure of merit. This is the figure of merit of graphene only. And so we wanted to see more in detail why was this figure of merit so high. So we went to see the Seebeck coefficient. The Seebeck coefficient was really high, actually, millivolts per Kelvin is a high Seebeck coefficient, and graphene only has a Seebeck coefficient of around 60 millivolts per Kelvin. And if you see here with the polymers and the nanoparticles, the polymers and the nanoparticles contributed very little to the high Seebeck. So it was graphene that was contributed to the high Seebeck, and this is really interesting, and this is something that we will be studying more in detail in the near future. And so the Seebeck coefficient was good because our graphene is not perfect. our graphene is wrinkled, and wrinkles actually induce peaks in the electronic density of states, and the peaks in the electronic density of states contribute to a high CVIC, and this is one of the reasons that we believe we have high CVIC, but also because when the layers land, they land rotated at random angles. They land turbostratic, and this turbostratic generates these more air patterns, and those more air patterns generate also peaks in the electronic density of states called the Van Hoff singularities, and we believe, you know, wrinkles and turbostratic orientation is what is giving us a good CVIC coefficient. And we went then to try 2D materials. There are thousands of materials that are also layered that you can exfoliate with sticky tape, but you can also exfoliate with liquid phase exfoliation. And a theory says that actually these materials are good for thermoelectrics, so we went to try it, liquid phase exfoliation. So these are the solvents that work the best for graphene. So NMP, N-methyl pyrrolidone, dimethyl formamide, and water does not work. And so you can produce 2D materials. We tried it, it's not as great. Even though it looks great, the power factor for this device is very low, so it's not as great, so this is something that we'll be improving soon. And lastly, sorry, 2 minutes, we decided to try those 2D materials, in particular, molybdenum disulfide for piezoelectrics. Piezoelectrics, you can harvest a potential through a mechanical force, and then you can do this with MOS2, because when you exfoliate it in odd number layers, and it's piezoelectric, and this is something that we inferred that we're having because odd layer number materials are not centrosymmetric and induce second harmonic harmonics on the surface and then produce graphene. But MOS2, this is MOS2. Yeah? Okay. So this is our conclusion. So graphene, nice. You can use it for thermoelectrics, but you can use it for many other things. Thank you.